Hey, it's Tim for Wrong Sports, and welcome to part two of this epic eight-year-long journey of the Prairie View football team and their record-setting losing streak. Before I start with part two, just to give you a quick recap, Prairie View A&M and most of their sports in the spring of 1990 dropped their sports program due to a financial scandal. They would come back the next year, though. This scandal and mismanagement would screw up the athletic department for most of the first half of the 1990s, resulting in a lot of losing for all of their teams. The Prairie View football team was the worst of all the sports, though, on campus, as it was now starting their fifth season of the decade, and they still haven't won a game. But starting in the fall of 1994, there were some changes on campus that wouldn't be felt until just before the 1995 season, which is where I will start today. But before I get to the end of this epic losing streak by Prairie View A&M, make sure you like this video, make sure you share this video, and of course, make sure you subscribe to the channel. Subscribe, please. Make sure you leave me a comment. Tell me what other streaks you want me to cover, because a lot of people have asked for me to cover Prairie View A&M, so that is why I'm covering it right now as we start with the 1995 season now. And I mentioned at the end of part one how there was some big news that would happen on the campus, and it happened in the spring of 1995, as Prairie View A&M University President Charles A. Hines reassigned Ronald Beard from his head coaching job to more of a teaching job and coaching of another team on campus. The president would also reassign the athletic director to another job, and a different person for both jobs would be coming in. The person he hired was Hensley Sapenter. He was 55 at the time of his hiring, and he just retired last month as athletic director of the San Antonio school system and thought he was going to retire. But in late July, he was talked into and hired by the president as football coach and athletic director at Prairie View A&M. Sapenter was recently a part of the Prairie View A&M Hall of Fame and played on great teams in the 1950s, but he wasn't ready for this job at all for a few reasons. The first was that he wasn't really ready for how bad this team actually was. As he said, "I don't know what the problems have been, other than I know that Prairie View's athletic program has succumbed to about as low as an ebb as you can get, and there is nowhere to go but up." Another reason was he hadn't coached football and hadn't coached any sport in years. He stated to Sports Illustrated in 1996, but he said of coaching that it was like swimming, and all he had to do was to just start doing it, and he would start to get the hang of it. Those words didn't sit well with the former coach Ronald Beard, as he would also talk to Sports Illustrated, and he said, "Mr. Sapenter is in for a rude awakening. Coaching and swimming are nothing alike. Can you imagine the shock he's in for? Kids today aren't like they were when he was coaching in the 1960s, and the game has evolved immeasurably since 1972. He's going to Prairie View, the only school in the conference without scholarships. I wish him the best, I really do. But the sad fact of the matter is that unless things change, he doesn't stand a chance." Yeah, obviously Mr. Beard was pretty mad about getting reassigned very late in the school year. It was so late, in fact, that Ronald Beard did interviews for national and local media leading up to the 1995 season. Also, when I was researching this video, I found that Ronald Beard is still acknowledged as the head coach of the team in the SWAC media guide, and Mr. Sapenter is not even mentioned at all. He's not even mentioned in the athletic director area. Unfortunately, though, this would end the time of Ronald Beard and his four-year coaching run, as he went 0-44, making him the only coach in NCAA history to end his career without a win after coaching more than two seasons. He would never get another football coaching job, and you have to really feel for him, as he would even acknowledge his fate as being a winless coach. But he had so many handicaps that his teams were just barely better than high school teams, and they were playing a D1 AA schedule. Beard would work for the university for years, and he would continue to watch the team, except he would watch it from the stands or from his television. But the 1995 season would start with Mr. Sapenter on an interim basis at the school to run the athletic department and the football team. He would get the job only if he could win. The school still had no scholarships and the lowest athletic budget in the SWAC, and probably one of the lowest in 1AA. According to a 1996 SI article, their entire athletic budget for 14 teams in 1994 was $849,000. so you know they were still using hand-me-down uniforms and had assistant coaches that were doing other jobs on campus. The team that was coming back was very different than last year's, as he didn't have his best two defensive players from last year, top tackler Provo and linebacker Gerald Crowder, who had 7 interceptions and ran 2 back for touchdowns, didn't come back. But he did have 4 out of 5 starters on his offensive line come back, as well as offensive players with some playing experience. But along with bringing in new players, he would just have to get the hang of coaching, so he would really have to rely on his assistants for most of the season, and it would show pretty early on. They started as usual Labor Day weekend versus Texas Southern, and this wasn't close like last year, and I'm sure most left at half as Texas Southern destroyed them 50-8. They would travel to Abilene Christian next, who were from the D2 level, and they weren't a very good D2 team. That didn't matter though, because it was 28-0 Abilene Christian at half, and it would be a 35-0 final. I do have some stats on this game, as Abilene Christian would have over 420 yards of total offense, while Prairie View managed only 197 yards. No matter the amount of yardage, they didn't get in the end zone, and they are now 0-2 on the year. They wouldn't get much closer to a win next, as they would play Southern, who were becoming a top team in the SWAC, and they made very quick work of Prairie View, winning 68-6. Prairie View A&M got another step down in competition, as they would play D2 team Tarleton State. They didn't give up 70 points to them this season, and they actually had a 6-0 lead, but that was when all the badness would happen. It would actually start happening on their PAT attempt, when their kicker, who had only attempted one other extra point kick, would kick the ball way too low, so low that it would go off the back of a lineman. It was fortunate for Tarleton State, who would pick up the ball and run it back for a 2-point return. Prairie View A&M still held a 6-2 lead, but then the next time the Panthers had the ball, they fumbled. Then they couldn't prevent a 3-yard touchdown run, despite having 12 defenders on the field. Then they lost the ensuing kickoff to lead to another short scoring run. After all that, it was Tarleton 32-6 with 11:04 left in the third quarter, and pretty much everyone would leave by that point. The final was 44-6. This game would be special, as they would lose their 50th straight game, and this was also the record-tying loss of the then longest losing streak by McAllister, which I went over in my worst D3 schools, and I'll put a link to that above. Prairie View A&M's biggest game was up next, as they would play Grambling in Dallas at the Cotton Bowl. Eddie Robinson was in his 53rd season. He was coming off a SWAC title in 1994, and he was going for his 399th win. Grambling had shut out Prairie View their last 2 years, and that streak would continue another year by an embarrassing volume again, 64-0. So whoever stayed around after the bands performed got to see history, as Prairie View A&M would cement their legacy with their 51st straight loss, and officially the longest losing streak in all of college football, any division. They played their yearly game against Oklahoma School Langston, and they lost, but they would score double digits in this game, as they got loss number 52 in a row by losing 48-12. I don't know if it was because they set the streak or that their next opponent was not that good, because Prairie View A&M almost won as they traveled to Alcorn State. Alcorn State was not the same team they were the last couple of years, mostly because they didn't have Steve McNair anymore. And because of that, they were coming into this game 2-4, and they were not scoring as many points as they used to score. Prairie View A&M's defense looked pretty good in this game, as they held Alcorn to only 13 points at half. Only thing was, Prairie View A&M also couldn't score, as they managed only a safety in the second half. The final was 13-2, but Prairie View didn't let Alcorn get anywhere near the end zone for the last half of the game. Prairie View A&M would play their final road game as they traveled to Alabama State, who crushed them 49-16, but the 16-point output by Prairie View was a top for them in the last 3 years. Prairie View A&M had homecoming up next, and it was their first home game of the season on October 28th. Mississippi Valley State was coming into this game 1-6 after a late win the previous week. Prairie View A&M couldn't do anything on their homecoming game, but less than 5,000 people showed up anyway. They did manage to score double digits, but they lost 35-14, and they got loss number 55. There were two games left, and this next one was a late addition. Again, this wasn't in the SWAC media guide. The reason for this game was probably because opponent Midwestern State was a Division II opponent and well under 500. And well, Midwestern State was pretty good against Prairie View because they had a 31-7 lead at half, and the final wasn't much off, as it was 37-15, so this late addition didn't work out for Prairie View. They were in their final game of the season, and it was another home game versus 7-2 Southern, who were undefeated in the SWAC and just needed to beat Prairie View to win the SWAC. Southern used this game as a tune-up for their finale and eventual play in the 1AA playoffs, as they crushed Prairie View 68-0. This ended the season as they would have 57 straight losses now. So another winless season was in the books, except this time there was a different coach. Coach Sapp was the coach this time. The offense, though, was horrible at the beginning of the season and got putrid by the end. They would score 79 points this season, which was 21 points less than the previous season and only 7 points per game. They were shut out 3 times, which was the most in a season since 1992. They were getting a lot better last year and not getting shut out. Their top passer this season was Reginald Prudhomme, who had 963 yards, 3 touchdowns, but he had 11 picks. On defense, they also got worse as they gave up 511 points. It was the most since their disastrous 1991 season. They really struggled, though, with the loss of Provo, but they did have the SWAC's second leading tackler in Otis Miles. He had 112 tackles. So it was clear that he was one of the few guys on defense that could play and could be trusted to get some tackles. This would end the second four-year class that has played or went to Prairie View and has not won a game. This is something I like to mention since in my previous video, like my Columbia video, it didn't get past 2 4-year classes, and this video we're going to be getting past, about 3 or 4 4-year classes. Along with that stat, it is also the end of the first season of athletic director and coach Sapp, and it wasn't the best season for him, but his second season would start his downfall at the university. The 1996 season is here, and it actually started pretty well. Now, I say that because this was the first season that they had scholarship players for the first time since 1989. It wasn't a big recruiting class, though, as they can only manage 15 scholarships, and partial ones at that. 15 is the minimum number you can have before you drop out of Division I AA. Athletic director and coach Sapender said of the scholarships, "No one should expect us to tear up the world because of these 15 scholarships. Hopefully we'll do better this year, merely from the standpoint that I personally had an opportunity to conduct a spring practice." Well, let's hope so, because he was able to get a better look at his team coming in this year as opposed to last year. He was bringing back his top quarterback from last year in Prudhomme, as well as his top receivers that had under a combined 550 yards, but that was 3/4 of the receiving yardage. Unfortunately, the offense wasn't bringing back 3 out of 5 of their offensive linemen from the previous year. On the defensive side, they wouldn't be bringing back Otis Miles, who was their best tackler last year, but they would be bringing back their third best tackler, who did play linebacker and DB, so that was good. But other than that, Prairie View wasn't bringing back anyone on their D-line, so that kind of means that things weren't going to be getting better anytime soon. The season started in Houston versus Texas Southern like it always does. The game started out fast for Texas Southern as they had a 21-0 lead at half, and it was 42-7 in the fourth quarter before the Prairie View A&M offense started to catch fire. If you were one of the 30,000 people in attendance that stayed after half after the bands performed, you actually got a pretty fun second half. Prairie View would score 2 touchdowns in the final 6 minutes, which were more points than they scored in several games the previous season. But the late scoring did nothing for them because they ended up giving up 515 yards in this game. The final was still 42-24. This gave Prairie View an 0-1 record on this year, and now the streak is at 58 losses. But along with the loss, there was actually some really big news that came after the game, as Prairie View A&M suspended its head coach and athletic director, Hensley Sapender, and started an investigation into possible infractions of NCAA and SWAC rules. The university would say in a statement that the allegations involved the use of ineligible players in that loss to Texas Southern. The school would do a huge review and investigation, and during that time, Coach Sipender would be suspended with pay. So the team would have to get ready for two Division II football teams in the next weeks, and they would have a new coach. This time, their linebacker coach, Fred Freeman, he would coach the team. Since he was coaching, this game was not a blowout like the last time Prairie View played them, but they didn't get close to winning, even though the final was kinda close, 30-14, so they held up a little bit. Next up, they played Hardin-Simmons, and the offense did what they did the previous game, scored two touchdowns, but that was pretty much all they could do and they lost again. This time it was a little worse, 42-12. So this gave Prairie View their 60th loss in a row and continuing to cement their long losing streak. The investigation would continue to rage on as Prairie View would play SWAC teams. It started embarrassingly against Southern as they lost to the SWAC champs this year, 63-0. They then traveled to Dallas next to play Grambling for the Battle of the Bands, and also another terrible football game. This year, Prairie View would score versus Grambling for the first time since 1992, but it was probably too late as Grambling would put up 50-plus points again to win 54-12. Prairie View would travel to Oklahoma next to play Langston University, and these games were usually when Prairie View played their best. They would play their best here, though, as they scored more points in any game that they played in the last 2 years, as they got in the end zone three times. They started by scoring first and actually had a 7-0 lead, but that went last. Langston eventually outlasted them 37-20, but Prairie View had over 300 total yards and over 200 passing yards. These next three games, though, they showed some change in Prairie View, as they were still coached by interim coach Fred Freeman, and their defense was getting a little bit better. Alcorn State would come to Prairie View first and shut out Prairie View, but it wasn't a crazy blowout by any means, as it was only 24-0, which sounds a lot better after being beaten 63-0 a few weeks previous. They would have another home game next versus Alabama State, and Prairie View would also have a QB change around this time, as they would start to play quarterback Josh Barnes, who was an undersized but very mobile quarterback, and was one of the 15 scholarship players on the team. That moving around and mobility was critical with a poor offensive line, as Prairie View managed to make it a game, as they lost by their closest margin in a while, 16 points. The final was 31-15, and the streak was now at 65 losses. Prairie View traveled to Mississippi to play Mississippi Valley State, and Mississippi Valley didn't crush Prairie View by any means. They didn't give up a lot of points, though. It was only 20-0, but Prairie View was shut out again. Homecoming was up next, and 8,451 people would show up for the game, and they were thinking that maybe this homecoming game could be when the streak would finally end. I don't think all of those people were showing up just for the bands. And big news was that Coach Sapp was going to be on the sidelines starting next week, so he would be in attendance for the game. Another thing was, they were going to be playing a pretty bad team. They were going to be playing a D2 squad called Midwestern State. They were 1-8 the previous year, so all signs were pointing to yes, that maybe Prairie View could finally win. But as you can see, there's a lot of time left in this video, so let's find out how this one got messed up. It was a scoreless affair until about 3 minutes left in the first half, as Midwestern State would score and then cause a turnover inside the Prairie View 40. They needed just one play to make it 14-0 at half. Prairie View would cut the margin to 6 with a touchdown and a 2-point conversion late in the third quarter, but that slim margin would only last a few minutes, as Midwestern State would score before the third quarter was over to make it 20-8. Prairie View would be able to score another touchdown in the third quarter, but couldn't convert on the extra point, and neither team would be able to score in the fourth, so this game ended 20-14. It was their closest loss and really their best game, as they were tied or within a touchdown for pretty much this whole game. I don't have all the stats, but I do have a little bit of stats on this game, and the star on the offense was Josh Barnes. He had 2 touchdowns as well as 120 passing yards and led in rushing with 20 yards. Their finale would come and Coach Sapp was back on the sideline. This game was significant. Well, not the game, because they got crushed 76-20, ending their season again 0-11. But it was because it was Coach Sapp's last game as coach. I'll get to more on him in just a second because I do have some stats on the season. First off, on offense, they had their best offensive year as they scored 131 points, or about 12 points per game. This was the first time they averaged double-digit points in about 8 years. Their best offensive player this year was a scholarship player, and he was a freshman. That was Josh Barnes. He was the quarterback who had 666 yards with 7 touchdowns and 10 interceptions. Meanwhile, on defense, they gave up 439 points. This was the third least amount of points they gave up, and it was a big improvement from the previous year. I don't know if it was because they were coached most of the season by their linebacker coach, Fred Freeman, but Freeman was also a coach at Hampton, so he knew how to be a good college coach. Their best player was Michael Patterson. He was named to the All-SWAC team in 1996 as a DB, and he also returned kicks. But let's get back to Coach Sepp. He wasn't under SWAC investigation anymore, but the investigation dragged on for so long that there were rumors of his firing coming soon. There were even job openings for the head coach of the football team being advertised. However, on February 6, 1997, Greg Johnson was named as the next head coach of Prairie View A&M. He wasn't named the athletic director, he was just named coach. Even though media outlets ran with it, the hiring wasn't official by the school, and it wasn't official for a few weeks due to a new athletic director needing to be hired as well. I even found an article that was basically another intro article to Coach Greg Johnson, where he talked about how he would run the program, and the newspaper was even mentioning how the hiring wasn't official yet, and this was in April. But Greg Johnson will be the new coach going forward, and would be official by the end of spring 1997. And with Greg Johnson's hiring, that would be the end of Coach Sepp, or Hensley Sepender. He was 0-22, and along with Beard has the rare distinction of being a coach with a winless record of more than one season. He was also given all the losses for the year, even though he was suspended for most of the 1996 season. Now, this guy is pretty controversial, even though he seems pretty tame to me. If you look him up pretty quickly, Ronald Beard really didn't have a lot of nice things to say about him, but that was because he was reassigned in his job. But also, after looking up this story, it's really hard to find a picture of Coach Hensley Sepender. I can't even find a picture of him on the sideline coaching. The best pictures I can find are these few right here, and the ones I've been using throughout this video. And also, after looking him up, I didn't really find much into the investigation. He apparently used players that were past their eligibility, but since the athletic department was in flux for pretty much the last decade, it really wasn't proven if he did that or not. Plus, Coach Sepp was accused of paying for part of the scholarships, which is against the rules, but again, this team only had 15 scholarships, which was 40 less than any team that gives out Division I AA scholarships. So this shows how low the budget was for this school, since it was 1996, and they were still running on a shoestring budget. But after mentioning all that, the streak lives on as we get to our third coach now. 36-year-old Greg Johnson would take over Prairie View A&M, and he was in for quite the job, as he would be coming from a familiar foe in Langston University. Johnson was a great young coach, as he was very good at Langston. He won 2 conference titles, he beat Prairie View A&M, and plus, he was a coach at the NAIA level, so he was used to having little or no scholarships, which was something he would have here at Prairie View. Another thing that Johnson had for him was that he was used to rebuilding a team, as he took over Langston football team and turned them around at the age of 30, so he was looking towards the future and towards rebuilding another program. Even before Greg Johnson had the head coaching job, he was talking to his players, as one defensive end, Quentin Young, said in an interview with the Panther, the newspaper, that Coach Johnson had a zero-tolerance policy for players that chose not to comply with the rules and the workout regimen. Again, this was said in April, before he was officially head coach, so Coach Johnson knew what he was in for and he was ready to get it done. Coming back for Prairie View this year was their best offensive player, Josh Barnes, and he would have a more experienced offensive line in front of him. On defense, Prairie View would have defensive back Quincy Fuller coming back, and the defensive line had a few scholarship recruits, so there was some hope in this line improving. And also, here's something else of note. They only played 9 games this season, 8 SWAC games and 1 out-of-conference game. I'm really surprised they couldn't schedule any Division II, Division III, NAIA teams to play them this year to try to get a win. Anyway, though, they started the season first Texas Southern in the Labor Day Classic, and this was a little closer than usual years. Prairie View A&M was only down 10-7 at half, but unfortunately Prairie View couldn't get closer, and they hurt themselves in this game with 7 turnovers. The final was 32-16. But next week would be the most interesting game of the season, as Coach Johnson's old team, Langston University, would come to Prairie View. With emotions high and a lot of people thinking they could finally win since he was playing his old team, the Panthers got off to a 1-point first quarter lead. But after 2 Langston scores, they were trailing as per usual at halftime, 13-7. The game was close after half, and despite outgaining Langston offensively 320 to 279 yard-wise, the Panthers fell in defeat 19-10. Yeah, this loss was really annoying due to the fact that Coach Johnson knew this team very well and he still couldn't pull it out. The embarrassing loss gave Prairie View loss number 70 as they continue to set a mark that no team would ever be able to reach. Okay, so last game was a kick in the balls, but this next game was pretty much a season ender as they played Southern. Southern were the best teams in the SWAC, and spoiler, they became the SWAC champs this year. The game wasn't much of a contest, as it was 21-0 after the first quarter and 42-0 at half. While the beatdown was happening, Prairie View would lose their best player, quarterback Josh Barnes. He would injure his shoulder, and he would be out all season. The game finally ended 63-7, but losing Barnes only made this worse. Next game was famous because it was versus Eddie Robinson, and it was in his final State Fair Classic. Over 55,000 people showed up to see the 1-2 Grambling cruise by to win 33-6, only allowing Prairie View 77 total yards. But what was bigger was that it was Eddie Robinson's 407th win, and this would be his second-to-last win at Grambling, as the next week he would score his final win before he retired at the end of the season. They would get loss number 73 next week as they would play Alcorn State, who were still improving on offense after McNair left a couple of years ago. The score wasn't too crazy, it was respectable. They lost 24-9. Prairie View always had media attention to them, waiting to see when that pesky win would finally come. And a lot of media attention paid attention to this game as they played winless Alabama State. But even though Alabama State was winless and they haven't won in a year, they cruised by Prairie View A&M 56-7. Prairie View looked like once again they were just trying to get to the end of the season any way they could, because these next two games kind of gave me that idea. They came back home after being on the road for almost 2 months to get shut out by Mississippi Valley State. A little over 9,000 people showed up because it was homecoming, but I'm assuming most of them left after the bands left at half. Prairie View A&M would welcome Arkansas Pine Bluff next, who were making their arrivals back into the SWAC, and of course they were used to beating Prairie View A&M. They never forgot how to beat them, as they would only allow Prairie View A&M to get 126 yards, 14 points, as they beat them again, 48-14. So we're at our finale of the season pretty quickly, and Prairie View is playing Jackson State. And according to their 1998 media guide, less than 400 people showed up, which might be true if they counted the attendance after a half. But anyway, the Panthers actually led after one quarter of play and held Jackson State to only 5 second half points. But unfortunately, they couldn't put over 20 points, so they lost in their finale 20-7. They ended their season an unusual 0-9 because they only played 9 games this season, and this season would end with their streak at 77 straight losses. And this streak really should have ended this year for Prairie View. I say that because their quarterback Josh Barnes, he led the team in yardage and touchdowns, and he only played 2 full games and didn't even play much of the third before the injury. He led the team with 597 yards passing, with 4 touchdowns and 6 interceptions. If he would have actually played 9 full games, he might have had 1,500 or maybe even 2,000 passing yards. But as a team, their passing offense was the better part of their offense, as they had 1,030 yards with 6 touchdowns and 19 picks. Their rushing attack had under 1,000 yards, and they were getting outgained 2-1 in pretty much every game. They only scored 76 points this season, but they only played 9 games, which averaged at about 8 points per game. On defense, their leader was Quincy Fuller, who had 57 total tackles and 2 sacks. Meanwhile, the defense as a whole only gave up 322 points, which was their lowest during this run, but that's probably because they only played 9 games. Greg Johnson would get another year on campus, and it would be the most significant season in the last 50 years for Prairie View. So that would be a little spoiler for the 1998 season, as they would bring in 15 new recruited scholarship athletes to the team. Along with that, they would return 27 of 46 lettermen from last year's squad. The list of returnees includes 7 offensive and 6 defensive starters from that 97 team. On the offensive side, they would have Josh Barnes back, and he would have an improved offensive line, as 4 out of 5 starters from last year would return. Meanwhile, on defense, Quincy Fuller, their best defensive player, was back, as well as their 2nd and 3rd best tacklers in their linebacking core. But let's start this 1998 season, because it's gonna be fun. They started, as always, versus Texas Southern. Even though scores were getting closer, Prairie View really wasn't coming close to beating Texas Southern any year. This year, they only lost by 11, and the score was much lower, 24-13, giving them loss number 78 to start this season. Next up was an out-of-conference game versus D3 opponent Howard Payne. They were dropping down to play this team, and they would play them on the road, which is strange, but they weren't drawing many fans, so it really didn't matter where they played. They were on the road, and they were playing a lower-level team, so you know that some people were watching to see if this was the game when their pain would finally end and they would win. Prairie View fought hard all game. They were within one score all game too, but they just couldn't pull it off, and they lost 22-14 to give them another loss to a team from a lower division. Southern was up next, and Prairie View traveled to Beaumont, Texas to play them. Prairie View might have been feeling the effects of the last game, because they weren't in this game at all, as they lost 37-7 to make them 0-3 in the season, and this loss was a big one because it gave them number 80. Yes, 80 straight losses. But another thing that happened during this game wasn't from the football team, but it was from the bands, as the Prairie View A&M and Southern bands would fight during halftime, resulting in both bands being suspended from several games, one of which was suspending Prairie View A&M from the Grambling game, which was one of the biggest for the school and the band, but the bands actually didn't listen to this suspension, which got Prairie View in more trouble at the end of the season. Let's move on, though, as Prairie View has 80 straight losses, and they were going on the road to Oklahoma to play Langston University. It was Coach Greg Johnson's old school, and the way the game started made it look like Prairie View was gonna lose this game to them again. It was 3-0 Langston at half, and Prairie View only had 49 yards. But after half, Prairie View stopped Langston all throughout the third quarter and scored twice on Kevin Bell runs of 57 and 69, plus they converted the extra points on both of them to be up 14-3. This was their biggest lead in a decade. They would need to hold on through the fourth quarter as Langston would get a field goal and drive in to score a touchdown with less than a minute to go. But on the two-point conversion, Prairie View stood them up and held them off to be up 14-12. But don't worry, nothing else bad happened. Prairie View won. They did it. It was over. The streak that started all the way back in 1989 was over in 1998. After 7 full seasons and 5 games, the streak was over. The Langston fans in attendance were shocked, and the Panther fans were shocked too, but they weren't shocked enough to tear down the goalpost of Langston. Also, the Prairie View A&M players and fans dug up portions of the turf for souvenirs. Again, it wasn't their field. Coach Greg Johnson would say after the game, "This time the other guy had missed opportunities. We've been there one time or two." The win didn't lead to a winning streak, it actually led to another losing streak, but Prairie View looked really good in their next 4 games after the win. They followed up with scoring 40 points in a shootout loss to Grambling, 55-40, and they had a new coach on the sideline in NFL Super Bowl winner Doug Williams. Then they got within 10 points in their next 2 games versus Alcorn State and Alabama State, and then Prairie View would play lower level team Oklahoma Panhandle, and they lost to them by 3. And this loss would have been bad, but they were just happy that they actually had one win this season. Prairie View A&M never got close in their final 3 games, and they ended this season 1-10. But this was the first time since 1989 that the fans could cheer that they ended the season 1-10. After the season, however, there would be some bad news, as Greg Johnson would resign and end his coaching run at Prairie View A&M. But it didn't end because he found a better job, it was because he broke NCAA rules by paying for a former player's tuition and housing with scholarship money available from players who had left the program already. Coach Johnson admitted to it by saying, "I got caught up in trying to do too much. and the school would make Clifton Gillard, the longtime on and off assistant and track and field coach, head coach in the 1999 season. Coach Gillard and his Panthers in 1999 won two games, more games than they won in the entire decade of the 1990s. But both wins were against teams in the Division II, Division III, or NAIA level. Gillard would only last this season, and Prairie View A&M would hire Larry Dorsey, who gave Prairie View A&M their first SWAC win since 1989 as they beat Alcorn State in 2000. And yeah, like I said, this streak is so epic. You can see how long it took me to go over it. It is the most epic streak in American football and probably the most epic losing streak in North American sports. Like I said before, I don't think the streak could ever be matched again without a team really cutting their budget and just absolutely not even caring about the team whatsoever. Plus, I don't think this could happen again because Prairie View had no scholarships from 1990 to 1995. Then from 96 to 98, they only had 15, which nowadays wouldn't make you a Division I school or an FCS school. It might make you just barely a Division II school, and you might be competitive at that level. And I said this before in my previous video that Prairie View just really should have taken off a year or two and just recruited players, practiced, scrimmaged, just try to get better instead of playing the 1991 and 1992 and 93 seasons because they were so far behind every school, not just schools in their own conference. They were behind Division II, Division III schools. They were pretty much on the level of an NAIA school, just barely above a high school team pretty much. I say that because from 1991 to 1993, this might have been the worst three-year stretch of any school I can find. They only averaged 5.5 points per game. They also gave up an average of 45 points per game through those 33 games. They were shut out 10 times out of 33 games. And like I said, they just had so many handicaps, it was just so unfair to them. But in total, during this 80-game losing streak, they gave up a total of 3,261 points, meaning that they gave up 43.5 points per game. This was higher than previous teams I have covered in my deep dives. They also gave up 60-plus points in 11 games, most of them from their first 3 years. And I covered that already. Plus, of course, they gave up 90 points in that game in 1991, which was just ridiculous. And during the 80-game losing streak, they scored 566 points, averaging 7.5 points per game. But that probably came from a lot in the 94 through 97 season when they actually scored 100 points or more in two of those seasons. But anyway, thank you so much for hanging out with me and watching both of these videos. I know they were long, but you asked for it, so I'm gonna do it. I covered the entire 80-game losing streak here at Prairie View A&M. If you have any other suggestions, now what other teams I should be covering, what other streaks I should be covering, winning streaks, losing streaks. I'm going to be doing some winning streaks coming up later on in the summer. I'm going to be doing some new lists coming up. But as always, make sure you like this video, share this video, subscribe, please, to the channel. As always, though, make sure you leave me a comment. Tell me what you liked about the video, what you didn't like about the video. And as always, find me on Twitter at SportsWronged. And I am going to rest my voice a little bit because I just did a lot of talking. Have a great day.